Thank you, Howard, for that beautiful rendition of that song. Definitely one of my favorites. I know to live is Christ. Definitely a prayer that we all want to embrace, that there is no other life I want to claim. It's to have more than just the ability to call ourselves Christian. We pray to be fully committed to Christ, to devoted to the teachings of Jesus, to find even a delight in the Lord, to be able to stand someday face to face with Jesus and to look deeply into the eyes of love that drench us with acceptance and mercy and love. Today, we heard about the face of Jesus, face to face. Jesus has taken Peter and James and John up a mountain to pray, and as he's praying, things change. His face changes. And yes, his clothes turn dazzling white, and Moses and Elijah appear in some form or another, but it's the face of Jesus that has transformed to such a degree that Luke thinks to mention it first. It's about his face. Luke writes from the Greek, the appearance of Jesus's face became other. The appearance of Jesus's face became other. The disciples, of course, they're startled, they're overwhelmed. And the text says a drowsiness comes over them. They feel weighted down with sleep. Now, you know what that feels like, don't you? When that need to sleep, that heaviness, whether out of exhaustion or stress or anxiety, dulls your senses, but heightens them at the same time. Your body goes into a place between asleep and awake. And you know, if you let go, you'll be snoring in seconds, right? But if you fight it, well, then your guard is down. Things get mystical and misty, and you enter a place of possibilities and visions that take shape before your eyes. The disciples are in that space, that drowsy heaviness of sleep space, but they fight it. And since they stay awake, the text says that they see Jesus and Moses and Elijah standing in the glory of the Lord. What a sight that must have been, right? And they overhear a discussion of Christ and the law and the prophets, which is, of course, what Moses and Elijah represent, about Jesus' impending journey to the cross, about Jesus' death. And that conversation rocks their world. There's no half sleep now, right? They're up. Well, what just happened here? Did you just hear that? Jesus is going to be killed? What does that mean? What does that mean for us who follow Jesus? 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 And Peter looks at the three figures in the pool of the glory of the Lord that they stand in and exclaims, I think it's good for us to be here. Let's build three tents, one for each of you. But as he's saying it, this cloud rolls back in, and they are immersed now in a physical fog, more uncertainty. They look back to Jesus. They want reassurance. They want to see his familiar face. Let's stop here a second. What does the face of Jesus look like to you? And I'm not talking so much about his physical appearance, though that certainly plays a big role. I mean, I remember as a child seeing the pictures of white, blonde, blue-eyed Jesus hanging in my Sunday school room, right? I learned that Jesus looked like me. I internalized that Jesus looked like me. It wasn't until I was older and I spent some time in, thank God, that fog of coming face to face with my own racism, that I looked into that or for that familiar face of Jesus for reassurance and all I knew, or at least all I thought I knew, so that Jesus could affirm my childhood truths, the pillars of my faith, and give me a sense of security and surety in my faith. But I realized that His face had indeed changed. Jesus wasn't all white at all. His face was the face of all people, all colors. The appearance of Jesus' face became other. So yes, the physical face is important, but I want to go beyond the physical because other things, beliefs, dogmas that we learned about Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit, those things we learn first, whether as children or as new Christians, those things we internalize and they become our surety. They become the pillars of our faith. They define the face of Jesus. And you know what? How we see that face, how we see Jesus, determines how we see the world, others, even ourselves. Now, I'm not saying it's easy. Some of those things that we've internalized, man, they are tough to let go of. Amen? I mean, what did you first learn about Jesus? Was he love? Was he judgmental? Was he exclusive? Was he forgiving? Was he accepting or condemning? Would the face of Jesus you saw first accept you as long as you were doing the right thing, love you when and if you said the right words or prayed the right prayer and loved the right way? What did that familiar face tell you about creation and your place in caring for the earth? What did it say about government, about authority in general, about the poor or the sick or the homeless or the marginalized? And when you looked at Jesus face to face, what did that face tell you about yourself? Whatever you learned, whatever Jesus's face looked like or looks like to you, I can promise you that face will change every time your faith is challenged by love. I mean, you know, that's the problem, right? Love. It's that love thing, right? It's bigger than we know, and doggone it, it just keeps growing. It just keeps getting bigger. It just keeps getting more radical. It keeps calling us to step out of our comfort zone more and more, do things in the name of love, live differently because of love, forgive more because of love, heal more, accept more, be more than we thought we could because of love. I mean, that's all that was happening to the disciples, frankly. Their faith was being challenged by love. They realized that Jesus' way, Jesus' mission, this radical love he lived out, would take them beyond what they knew, what they were sure of, what they were familiar with. So naturally, like all people, when we get challenged like that, their instinct and our instinct was return to the familiar, return back to what we know, where it's safe. For Peter, the building of these three tents for each of them, this was something he understood. Surety. The temple for Peter was where God lived, a building where we worship. It's what Peter knows. It's what we rush to get back to even now. It represented security, home, safety, where spiritual needs are met, that house, that tent. This was a learned, familiar pillar of his faith. The thing is, God doesn't leave us in the familiar, and God does not leave us fearful or confused, and he didn't for Peter either and the rest of the disciples. God's voice cuts through the cloud strongly. This is my anointed, my chosen one. Listen to him. And Moses and Elijah fade from view, and Jesus stands alone, looking back at the disciples with a brand new face. course, then, Peter realizes that Jesus doesn't need a house at all, right? That God is bigger than any human tent, that the Spirit can't be contained, no building. And yeah, it took a second for Peter to embrace the change in the face of Jesus he thought he knew. It takes a while to realize that this new, radical way of following God and love would lead Jesus, as well as his followers, as well as Peter, as well as us, to the cross. Maybe that's why the disciples didn't tell anybody what happened on that mountain for a long time. Sometimes we need to adjust in ourselves, in our own spirits, to Jesus being bigger than what we first thought. But stay with me just a moment longer, because what happens next in the text is just as important. So the disciples are trying to come to grips and process all of this stuff. Jesus leads them back down the mountain, and the very next day, they're out with a boy with a demon. They're out doing hands-on ministry, calling out the demons of the world, standing with the suffering, healing the untouchable, challenging the idea that God's love is in any way exclusive or conditional. That's ministry. Now, even at that point in ministry, the disciples don't have the whole picture. They don't have a clear definition of all that's going to happen to them or to Jesus. But you know what they did have a clear picture of? That no matter what, they were sticking with Jesus. That they might not get it all, they might not have a full comprehension of what's going on, but the one thing they were sure of, Jesus was for real. That he talked about love and he lived love. Love like they had never seen before, given to people who hadn't received it before. Jesus showed the love of God for all, to all. Jesus accepted all, forgave all, broke down the walls of tradition built to contain God, and brought forth a new view of what could be that they had never imagined, a view of the world that they could have never envisioned, a view of themselves that they had been taught did not exist. And they might have not fully understood it, but they were changed. That new face of Jesus caused the appearance of their own face to become other. That's the most beautiful, most unbelievable thing that could happen to us, isn't it? That after we've committed ourselves to being close to Jesus and devoted ourselves to Jesus and delighted ourselves in Jesus, our own face changes. All the things that we've believed about ourselves and each other, all the things that we've been taught about ourselves and understand about our face becomes other. We look in the mirror expecting what we know to be familiar, but what we see face to face in our own eyes is drenched in acceptance and mercy and love. We see Jesus in our face. It's what happens to us when we live out this radical way of loving and including and forgiving and healing and restoring and reconciling. People don't understand. The world, yes, the world thinks we're foolish. People and parties and publics, they'll get angry with us just as they did with Jesus and his disciples. Yet, we set our faces that maybe a minute ago we thought looked one way, and now all of a sudden they look a different way. We set our faces toward Jerusalem and begin our own journey toward the cross together with Jesus leading the way, face to face. May God bless you this morning.